Hey, fellow health accumulators. Dr. Matt here. We're talking about phytic acid today. And if you've been around the paleo community, the keto community, say the last 20 years, you've probably been schooled on the horror that is consuming phytic acid on any kind of regular basis. And been told that, you know, phytic acid consuming foods are not meant for us. Nobody was eating them 2,000 years ago, all those kind of things. So what is phytic acid anyway? That's P-H-Y-T-I-C. So phytic acid is essentially the storage form of phosphorus, that mineral, in a plant. And phytic acid is most commonly found in foods like grains, say your wheat products, buckwheat, seeds, legumes, nuts. There's also a small amount that's found in like roots and tubers, say your sweet potatoes or cassava. Okay, those cassava tortilla chips, those cassava flour tortillas going on these days. Much more common here in the industrialized world. And so it's often demonized as an anti-nutrient, you know, that we must destroy at all costs this phytic acid so that we don't become deficient in minerals like, say, calcium or iron or magnesium or manganese, copper, zinc, pretty much any of these 2+ cations. If there's phytic acid, we're going to be deficient. After all, you know, phytic acid, you know, it can essentially chelate to or bind to these 2+ minerals and decrease our body's ability to get to them and absorb them. This is in fact true. This is factual. That is a fact. But thankfully, as with most stories, when it's told about whole foods, the anti-nutrient part, the part getting all the hoopla related to phytic acid, and is really a very narrow view that leaves a whole host of people, you know, literally scared of eating any foods containing phytic acid. Literally, people think, and I say literally because I have patients who think this, not only that, are these anti-nutrient foods, but like they're going to just destroy their bones. They're going to be massively anemic. If they eat nuts or seeds or say sweet potatoes, on a regular basis, because, these foods have these anti-nutrients, this phytic acid in it. But rest assured, this is not the case. Yes, phytic acid is present in foods, but there's a whole another part of this story. So I often wonder, you know, if people or experts who are, putting out this story and a lot of stories related to whole foods, if they're doing it intentionally, you know, just to gather attention, because of course fear does sell. There's no doubt about it. Fear's selling, and we've noticed that over the last couple of years, fear is really selling. Or perhaps, maybe it's because they just, they're in the Western model of medicine and therapy and stuff, and they just have an inability to think in a holistic manner. Well, either way, for the health of myself, yourself, our families as a whole, because we want healthy families, right? I think it's a good idea that we revisit phytic acid and gain maybe a better understanding of what's actually going on with phytic acid. So for instance, you sit down to eat your oats, maybe some sliced almonds, you sit down, eat your sweet potato, your new buckwheat special, your black beans, you name it. Are you now consuming a load of phytic acid? Well, that depends. Did you soak those beans? Did you sprout that buckwheat? Did you ferment that flour or cook that sweet potato containing phytic acid that you're about to consume? If so, and I would say almost all of us at least cook our food, right? We're not just eating raw beans. Then you've significantly reduced your phytic acid content in your food. Is it to zero? Probably not. But you've significantly reduced it. And now consider a single meal. This is the part where I think it's overlooked many times. You sit down and eat a single meal with phytate in it. And we call phytate is basically the phytic acid bound to a mineral. We call it phytate. If you sit down to a single meal, you're not taking that meal into your next meal to next meal to your next meal. So you can be, you know, the amount of phytic acid that bound your minerals for that meal you had that had, say, a piece of toast with it, or had some almonds with it, or you know, soybeans or something like that with it. Yes, there were minerals bound up. If there was phytic acid present in that meal, there was minerals bound up in that meal. But come lunchtime, you're not binding the rest of your minerals because you eat that one meal with some phytic acid in it. And I think this is overlooked and not properly understood, is that you don't carry it for every meal, which is why you're not going to be just depleted of all your minerals by eating a single meal, or even five meals, or eating a meal every single day, one meal that contains some phytates in it. So we got to get that point across. Eating oatmeal for breakfast is not going to ruin the rest of your day and make the rest of your day full of a bunch of anti-nutrient activity. All right. So when might we want to pay special attention to the amount of phytic acid in our food substance? One, if you are a vegetarian, or if you're vegan, because you're eating things with a lot of phytic acid probably all day long. You know, if you're eating a lot of soy products, soy is one of the highest phytic acid containing foods. So you're going to want to be careful if you're eating tons and tons of soy products. Or are you a child? Are you a child that's anemic, or an adult who's anemic? You know, are you getting sick all the time? You know, potentially, you know, if you're having issues with, say, zinc absorption, you're getting sick a lot, or you're having a breakdown of your nails or your skin or hair. Those both could be iron and zinc issues. And so maybe you'd want to be extra cautious about the amount of phytic acid. And I would say generally, you know, for a growing child, I do consider the amount of phytic acid my children are getting. And we cook things and sprout things and that kind of thing. But if you're getting a broad range of food, then, you know, it's not going to be as big a deal. But say if your child is not getting a broad range of food, and, you know, they're just eating lots and lots of breads and nuts and seeds and, say, potato matter and maybe some beans or rice and these kind of things, sure, they're going to become depleted. I mean, there's lots of studies showing that, you know, if you just eat a bunch of rice, polished rice, that's an anti-nutrient. There's no nutrients in it, and yet there's going to be some anti-nutrients in it, and you're going to be depleted because you're just eating over and over and over rice. But there are many reasons beyond, you know, phytic acid for why we might want to soak or sprout a nut or a seed. But I would say, you know, in our family, we pretty much always, or 100% of the time, we don't eat raw nuts, we don't eat raw seeds, because there are a lot of other substances in there, one, that could be potentially problematic for the human body and just slowing down the digestive capacity of these foods. But I will say phytic acid is not something I really even consider related to why we soak or sprout or roast our nuts and seeds. It's mostly to break down other components in it, which we can get into another time. But, you know, I see videos of people going to just insane lengths to literally get every bit of phytic acid out of their grains, out of their nuts, out of their seeds, out of their beans. And I'm not saying there's nothing necessarily wrong with this, but I think for most of us, you know, we want to get whole, real food into our children, whole, real food into our lives. We want to, you know, flourish in health. We want to accumulate health. And we probably don't want to spend, you know, 78 hours a day in the kitchen trying to figure out how to get all the stuff out and, you know, have this huge process by which you go about, you know, making breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Because it seems like so much more intensity and so much more time spent in food preparation than is necessary, and really not like this exceptional health being gained by this extra preparation, I guess is the biggest thing. So the thing is, say you had a piece of sprouted grain bread, but it wasn't the sprouted bread, or the sprouted bread wasn't fermented. So there was still some residual phytic acid in the bread that you're consuming. Like I said before, you can eat that sprouted bread and feel okay. You know, this, you're eating it at that meal, and during that current meal, you will have a little bit of mineral binding that would be, say, greater than you would have if you know, maybe you would have fermented that sprouted grain and turned it into a sourdough bread. Because if you do sour bread long enough, it does seem to completely eradicate all the phytic acid. So if you're concerned about iron or calcium or zinc, you know, these things, or manganese, and being deficient in those, you could always eat foods or take your supplements at another time during the day. And I think you should. I mean, I would not supplement with iron or calcium at the same time, you know, I eat a big bowl of oatmeal. Probably not the best idea, because there's gonna be some binding happening, and it's gonna decrease the effectiveness of the supplement. So I'm just like kind of be wasting some money right there, and wasting some minerals. So when phytic acid is consumed, it literally binds to a mineral, and we call this new structure phytate. And this is kind of where the story changes. So during the process of digestion, phytate, this phytic acid mineral bond, gets broken down into something called IP6. And this is a really, really long word with all a bunch of kind of numbers in it, chemical kind of thing. So I'm gonna leave it at IP6. But if you've been in the integrative oncology community or been even treated for cancer in, you know, some kind of integrative setting, then say in the last 30 years, then you've probably come across, or you've maybe had as part of your therapy, IP6. This inositol hexaphosphate substance that came from phytic acid and the mineral coming together, creating phytate, and then getting broken down into this IP6. Because IP6 has all these anti-cancer properties. In fact, you know, I just pulled a study published December 15, 2020 that, you know, spoke to these and, you know, talked about, you know, like the last 30 years, all this research we have on IP6. And it's reducing cancer cell proliferation, it's inducing of apoptosis, which is essentially the death of these cancer cells, as well as its immune enhancing effects, its antioxidant properties that it carries and contribute to basically the breakdown and destruction of tumor cells. And there's also studies on IP6 talking about how it helps with cholesterol balance, blood sugar regulation, insulin sensitizing, and leptin regulation, leptin balance, you know, helping with your appetite. So I'm just thinking, and I think we should always think about this holistically when it comes to whole foods, is, you know, this stuff sounds great, right? These benefits sound amazing related to phytic acid. So what if, you know, we led with the anti-cancer, the anti-obesity, anti-diabetes effects of phytic acid, you know, as it gets broken down to IP6 in the gut, rather than, you know, its anti-nutrient mineral depletion effects. And I feel like potentially, you know, it just kind of depends on the circle of medicine you find yourself in, nutrition you find yourself in, but also is like, one is like hope bringing, the other one is fear bringing. And in our world, fear is what sells, unfortunately. So I think maybe that's why everybody ran to this anti-nutrient effect and maybe away from the potential benefits to, you know, metabolic syndrome and cancer or anti-cancer. All right, so what should we do? I suggest just don't overthink it. You know, if you take an iron supplement, if you're anemic and then you're having a bowl of oatmeal while you're taking an iron supplement, like I said before, bad idea. You know, eating a bunch of walnuts while you're taking your iron supplement, bad idea. If you're taking, you know, trying to get your zinc levels up, you want some extra immune support because your zinc might be low, these kind of things, then, you know, taking your zinc with a bunch of grains or beans or lentils or nuts or seeds is a bad idea. You know, take it someplace else, you know, give it a couple hours away from those meals. Then you can gather, you know, you can have that, your great breakfast, you know, your oats and walnuts or whatever you like. But you can also get all the benefits of, say, the supplement you're consuming to help with the nutrient, the mineral deficiency you have. Or, you know, you can just eat a well-rounded meal, you know, have some beef later on, have some fruits and vegetables, those kind of things later on, or roast or, you know, ferment, you know, do all the things that help with the digestibility of these food substances. Because yeah, I think, you know, sprouting is awesome. I think fermenting your food is awesome. I think, cooking your food is exceptional. I would do all these things. In fact, we pretty much always buy and use sprouted oats. Because sprouting alone, or germination, has been shown to increase the bioavailability of these minerals we're talking about, even from like 40% to 98%, depending on the grain you're using, how long you're sprouting, and that kind of thing. So we want these minerals, right? We need these minerals. They're a big deal, super, super important. I'm not downplaying that whatsoever. But if you cook, if you sprout, if you ferment, if you do one of these things, you are greatly increasing the bioavailability of these minerals. And you can expect that your nuts, your seeds, your potatoes, your beans, your grains, you know, not only are you greatly increasing their digestibility by doing these things, but you are breaking down some phytic acid, increasing the ability for you to get to those minerals. But it's not like you got to do all four of them. And it's not like you got to spend day after day. In fact, so many times you even just buy your, you know, oats sprouted now. I'm all about doing everything you can at home. That's awesome. And, you know, gaining these skills, because you're probably going to need these skills in the very near future with the way the world is going. But please do not get stressed out about it. Don't let it, feel like I'm damaging my family, the health of my family by not doing, you know, these 14 different things before you put the food on the table. All right. So let me know where you're at when it comes to sprouting with phytic acid, fermenting different foods, soaking your foods. I would love to hear what you guys do. We can learn so much from each other, how to make things more efficient, do things better, and make it so that we each can have, you know, families that thrive. That's the goal of all this, is that we accumulate health, and in accumulating health, not only do we thrive, but our families thrive. All right, so I'm Dr. Matt. Please like, subscribe, pass it around. If you have anybody that's out there that's, you know, excessively scared of phytic acid, I hope this brings some light. Talk to you guys later.